Oliver Tambo,
Oliver Tambo, Tetano,
Patria o Muerte.
يا جسر الأقزان أنا سميتك جسر العودة
جسر العودة جسر العودة
You call upon to help the discouraged beggars in life's marketplace. One day we must come to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring.
You are here because you are promoting the communist cause.
I am here because I am opposing the neo-fascist cause.
Radical History Reviews on 104.5 WRFU, Radio Free Urbana. Warning, this program features language from historical sources of European colonialism that some listeners may find uncomfortable. The notion of time as a calculable duration is completely unknown to the black man. He has not the slightest notion what 5 years are and what he should understand by that. He just signs a contract for the term of 5 years, and when these have elapsed, the owner of the plantation can easily tell him, "You have only worked 5 months for me." And one thing is certain, only a small percentage of the unfortunates who have been shipped to the islands of West Africa will ever leave them again. These are the words of German capitalist Max von Esser. The member of a wealthy German banking family, Esser traveled to the colony of German Cameroon, or Deutsche Kamerun, in 1896 with a company of other so-called explorers. Working in close contact with the German colonial administration, he was looking for workers, trying to recruit for a great colonial investment in Deutsche Cameroon, cocoa plantations. At the beginning of the 20th century, the German Empire of Kaiser Wilhelm II had a global empire whose total landmass was several times the size of mainland Germany and Europe. German Southwest Africa, which was a colony forming most of contemporary Namibia, was equivalent to about 1.5 times the landmass of mainland Germany alone. From the 19th century until the outbreak of the First World War, tens of thousands of Germans lived in the colonies of German Cameroon, German Southwest Africa, German East Africa, German Qingdao, German Samoa, and other imperialist possessions. In these colonies, Germans like Esser reproduced the structures of Wilhelmine society that they had left back in the German mainland. Through flows of capital, commodities, and people, both Germans and colonized, exploitative Germans recreated their native capitalism in the global south. In this process, new relations to property, work, leisure, gender, family, and other societal structures were born. More often than not, these changes were imposed on native peoples. Rarely, some natives embraced these changes and worked with the Europeans towards quote-unquote progress or towards quote-unquote civilization. To many Europeans, like Esser, Africans were in something of a state of Lockean nature. Unlike Europeans, they had never left this state of nature to create a social contract, to create a new society together, as civil equals. Instead, they literally lived off the land to European eyes. It was perceived that Africa, like South America, was so luscious and rich in greenery that it even made the Africans lazy and prevented their advancement into this civil society. Important, then, to the goal of the European, quote-unquote, civilizing of Africa was European culture. And this culture will be brought by European science and economics. As Bernard Dernberg, head of the Imperial Colonial Office, or Reichskolonialamt, put it in a 1907 address, colonialism meant, quote, making useful the earth, its resources, the flora, the fauna, and above all, the people for the benefit of the economy of the colonizing nation, which is then obliged to give in return its higher culture, its ethical concepts, its better methods. Many Europeans at the turn of the century then viewed colonialism as a type of mutually beneficial exchange in which Africans exchanged their labor and economic production for European civilization. Working on European-style plantations, working as servants in colonial houses, serving expeditions like Max von Esser's, serving in the colonial militaries, navies, and guards were some of the ways in which Africans, it was thought, would receive their fair share of lessons in applied European civilization. By learning to exploit nature for maximum production and profit, as the Europeans did, Africans could learn to escape from it into civilization. This was the context in which Max von Esser set out in 1896 for his expedition to recruit plantation laborers. Esser's target was the kingdom of Bali, which lay hundreds of miles inland from the Cameroonian coast. Before him, other Germans had tried to recruit members of the nearby Douala peoples for the same task. Douala was the kingdom on the coast where the German colonial capital of Cameroon of the same name, Douala City, was. But the Douala, to the Germans, had a reputation of being poorly suited to the task of the plantations. As Esser put it, quote, "It is impossible to engage the coastal population as workers. For centuries, they have lived from trade. One can hardly imagine the unbelievable indolence of the Douala and their distaste for hard work. Other African coastal groups have initially provided the necessary labor." End quote. But more workers were needed for Esser and the other enterprising Germans to run cocoa plantations in Cameroon. Esser had excitedly written out the economics of his proposals. Quote, "One hectare with 500 cocoa bushes to be planted in a year needs 2 laborers. One can work out from that 400 workers are needed, under 6 Europeans, to plant some 100,000 trees a year. If nowadays black workers earn 300 marks per annum and white 3,000, planting 1 cocoa bush costs about 1.4 marks. End quote. The math for the exploitation of native workers was there. Esser simply needed human laborers to realize his schemes. With the proper know-how, he thought that he and other Germans could profit from cheap African labor and bestow to the Africans the gifts of their civilization's knowledge and culture. So, in 1896, with his company of dozens of Dualan and other native African guides, Esser set off to find King Galega of the Bali and attempt to negotiate a treaty with him to secure more plantation workers. After many months of traversing the Cameroonian jungles, a journey that would in total cost dozens of men, most of whom were African hired hands, Esser arrived on the grassy fields of the Bali Kingdom, in the interior of the African continent. It was a journey that would have made some of the colonialist explorers Esser had surely read about, people like Mungo Park, Dr. Livingstone, Alexander von Humboldt, and Henry Morton Stanley, very proud indeed. The town of Bali was described by Esser as, quote, "built on both flanks of a hill on the very top of which is situated Galega's palace, which fronts a big marketplace. From here starts a broad main road which goes along the ridge of the range, on which are built, symmetrically facing each other, 100 houses on each side. When Esser and his troops marched up to the top of the hill near the marketplace, they gave off a loud salute with 25 guns. As they neared Galega's palace, Bali men, women, and children threw palm leaves on the ground in front of them and surrounded them, dancing and shouting with excitement. It's believed that, at the time of this visit, the town would have had several thousand residents. When they arrived at the palace, King Galega greeted them seriously, trying to show off his great power and wealth. According to Esser, he, quote, sat upon a throne of ivory. In front of him was spread a costly carpet. He sat like an iron statue, without even batting an eyelid, directing his glance fixedly and sternly upon us. At his left sat about 40 old men, the elders of his people, holding huge tobacco pipes between their knees. Esser and his men were to sit on stools provided by Galega, and nearly 1,000 warriors flanked their gathering in a wide circle. Galega rose and shook hands with each of the men. Galega bade them, through his interpreter, to sit down, and then his people clapped their hands 3 times in a greeting. Last, to establish trust, there was a simple ceremony of sharing kola nuts and palm wine. King Galega then spoke through his interpreter. "The king welcomes the white men in his country. The whites are clever and powerful. Therefore the king loves them, has ordered houses to be built for them, and he hopes that they grow fat during their stay with him, for the march seems to have weakened them." Esser carefully answered Galega, stoking his ego and telling him that the knowledge of his fame and power had reached Germany. Then, with the ceremony concluded, they went to the houses Galega had built for them to rest. The Germans with Esser would spend a total of 6 days at Galega's camp, a time of many ceremonies and diplomatic celebrations. On one of the last days of the trip, they finally began negotiations with Galega over the question of him supplying laborers to the Germans at the coast. But first, they had to exchange gifts. Galega had earlier given Esser and his troop some kola nuts, some palm wine, and several women, the last being a gift that Esser had flatly called useless in his notes. To Galega, they gave a set of German armor, sugar, a commodity that was not available in Cameroon other than by import of the Europeans, and a mechanical throne that sang out German national songs when sat upon. In the course of a long night, during which Esser estimated about 50 liters of palm wine were drunk, the Germans finally discussed their question of labor supply for German plantations with Galega. At first, Esser notes, Galega, quote, did not want to hear anything at all about it. He would need his people to wage wars. He could not send them away. Esser then tried to convince him how the power and prestige of his people would grow through work and lasting peace, how the prosperity of his country would increase, how he himself would have a higher income, and to put it at its crudest, how he would always be able to enjoy sugar and palm wine. It was the sugar that had the most effect, and Galega began to consider how the proposal would be of advantage to himself, and therefore as more acceptable, and promised to discuss everything with his elders. 2 days later, they negotiated again on the topic. Galega would now allow several hundred people a year to go to the coast to work the plantations. Some taxes were established regarding headcounts and bridge tolls for passing through the jungles on the way to the coast, jungles belonging to other native Cameroonian tribes. Furthermore, the German protectorate was to see to it that the Bali would no longer be molested or harassed by neighboring tribes. Esser and his troop returned to the coast. Only one German stayed, Dr. Eugen Sintgraf, who had earlier led similar expeditions to Bali. He was to stay and convert the colonial station there into a plantation, into Baliburg. He would later lead the first group of Bali workers to the plantations on the coast. Buried deep in some German parliamentary reports, or colonial administrative reports, we can find some details of what life was like for the workers of German plantations in Cameroon. At their worst, these documents show the full horrors of the colonial labor system. At their best, they show how unpleasant plantation life was. In 1905, Johannes Zemler, a Liberal Party member of parliament, journeyed to Cameroon to investigate and report back on the quote-unquote progress of the colonial administration there. He reported that there were both free and slave laborers at work on the plantations, some of which were from the Bali tribe which Esser had recruited. Some of the slaves present came in the form of punishments that had been doled out to other tribes by the German government. When tribes would rebel against the German government, one of their punishments could be to be forced to send laborers to work on German plantations. Ultimately, Johannes Semler's report indicated that native laborers had mixed treatment. While their basic needs were met, their working conditions were horrible. Plantation work was hot, sweaty, very intensive physical labor, and plantation laborers frequently worked all day with few breaks. For the hundreds of Bali sent to work by their king and Esser, this was the reality that they faced. Their gift, in exchange for working plantations at the coast, was the slow matriculation of German culture, a culture that told them to dress a certain way, to keep time, that field work was men's work and housework was for women. It was a culture that told them that they should plant crops in homogeneous neat rows rather than intermixing and using polyculture farming as they had done. It was a culture that identified them as workers first, as individual proletarians, rather than as members of a family and kingdom, members of a larger whole. And what would they now think of their king, Galega, who many had previously fought for and worshipped? What would they think of a man who had sold them into this type of slavery? If they were unable to embrace the new identity Europeans gave to them, they would surely have trouble finding their old. This story is one small reminder of what empire, what colonial capitalism, did to native people. In backroom dealings with their leaders, in negotiations between Europeans on a continent thousands of miles away, the fates of people like the Bali in Cameroon could be decided. Max von Esser's expedition led to the virtual enslavement of hundreds of Bali, all for the personal profit of his cocoa plantations. It's the legacy of stories like that of the Bali that we should think about when we hear that Europeans are hoping to invest in places like Cameroon or other former colonies. We should remember that with capitalism, what the capitalists and colonizers consider to be opportunity for some can be traumatic forced changes to the lives of others. At the beginning of the show, I gave a quote from Esser where he was talking about how Africans lack any sense of European time, and that plantation owners on islands off the coast of West Africa use this to their advantage, convincing Africans that they have not yet served up their contract of 1 year. Africans who had been forced into virtual slavery on places like Sao Tome and Principe would have no way to contest that their contracts had expired. How could they when they came from societies that had totally different conceptions of what time was? Conceptions of time as something not revolving around work and production. Esser and other colonialists like him in Cameroon considered themselves to be much more moral colonizers than those on Sao Tome and Principe who had done this to the Africans, who had duped them into staying long past the expiration of their contracts. In 1905, Otto Arendt, another German member of parliament, a conservative member, recalled in his report upon his visit to Cameroon how the return of leaders of his black escort to their plantation in the interior near Bue was met with a Freudenfest, or a period of song and dance, a period of great celebration. Earlier, at the palace of Governor of Cameroon, Governor von Puttkamer, Otto Arendt had been surprised pleasantly when the members of the Black Schutztruppe gave him a concert, which was, quote, a surprising performance of the Negro music, end quote. And this was a black regiment of the German army which had been conscripted from the natives. Johannes Zemler, in his parliamentary report, also seemed to think the Cameroonians working at the German plantations on the coast were in good health and doing all right. The parliamentary visitors could only conceive of the black Africans as happy and docile. It reminds one almost of the ways in which those who tried to justify slavery in the antebellum United States would frequently comment how African Americans there seemed to be, again, happy and docile, contented with their situation. Indeed, the historian Andrew Zimmerman has made this connection between the U.S. South and German colonial plantations in Africa very apparent in his book all about the connections between the Tuskegee Institute and the German colonial administration. In his book, Alabama in Africa, Booker T. Washington, the German Empire, and the Globalization of the New South, he discusses all of these connections and how Tuskegee Institute members literally went over to Germany to give conferences and confer with the Germans about how to design plantations similar to the U.S. sharecropping plantations in the German colonies in Africa. Another area in which the Germans perceived themselves as the good and glorious colonizers, those giving their part of culture and science to the Africans in exchange for their labor, was in medicine. In the 1905 report for Parliament, Otto Arendt reports in glowering terms about one of the hospitals in Douala, led by a Commander Zeman, one of the chief German scientists at the time, and how it had been so effective in reducing cases of death from malaria, down from thousands in earlier generations to very few in that current generation of Africans and whites alike in 1905. Elsewhere in Africa, as part of one of the first truly international medicine campaigns, French, German, and British colonial scientists and researchers worked together to combat the sleeping sickness, a virus which was afflicting thousands, especially in East Africa, of German and other colonized laborers, making them unable to work, which was chiefly the reason why the Germans got involved. George Steinmetz, a scholar at the University of Michigan, has written a lot about the international networks of scholars who worked to justify colonialism throughout Africa, saying that they were benefiting Africans with their revolutionary science that they were bringing to them. My point is that most of the Germans active in colonialism did not think that they were doing anything wrong. It was inconceivable to them that what they were doing was in fact hurting the African peoples more than benefiting them. It was inconceivable to them that their bargain, their deal of trading their science and culture in exchange for African labor, was not a fair one. Where the historian or the native sees exploitation and the forced colonization of their land, their people, their resources, and the forced change of hundreds of ways of life of these different cultures, of these different peoples, the German colonizer at the time just saw quote-unquote progress and quote-unquote civilization coming to Africa. Capitalists and the states that serve them all too often are blind to the suffering and the exploitation that they cause. In their place, they see progress. In their place, they see science. In their place, they see civilization encroaching rather than misery and humanity suffering. And this is a lesson that I think still holds today in the wake of the G20 summits that we see every now and then at luxurious Swiss resorts in Davos, or in the wake of the International Monetary Fund demanding access to Venezuela or demanding access to Iran to give them loans to help them to civilize them. We should remember the past. We should remember that this is how colonial states, empire states, operate. This is how states as agents of capital operate, under the guise of civilization and progress. In their drive to make it legible to their domination, states and the capitalists that they serve abstract the humanity right out of the world. I'm Nick Goodell, and thank you for joining me for this episode of Radical History Reviews on 104.5 WRFU Radio Free Urbana. WRFU is an open forum for the community, and the views I have expressed here do not reflect those of the Urbana Socialist Forum, the Urbana-Champaign Independent Media Center, or WRFU 104.5. As we are an open forum, that means that anybody can get a show or start their own podcast using WRFU's equipment. If you are interested in starting your own show or podcast on WRFU, you can email us at wrfumanager@ucimc.org. Again, that's wrfumanager@ucimc.org. All episodes of Radical History Reviews will be uploaded to my YouTube channel of the same name, that's Radical History Reviews on YouTube. All past episodes are also available to stream on demand anytime from the WRFU website. That website is www.ucimc.org/WRFU_104_5. Stay tuned for more local great programming by the people for the people of WRFU 104.5 LP Urbana.